So this class is the continuation of the last class which we have started last day, that was dynamic of particle and rigid body. In the last class we have covered the linear motion. Now today we will go for the curvilinear motion. Curvilinear motion means when a particle or a rigid body follows a curve path. See, when the particle moves along a straight path, we only need a single vector to describe it path. But when the same particle follows a curve path, to define its motion properly, we need minimum two vectors, one tangential and one the normal. First, let us take an example. Here, a particle is moving along a curve path, as you can see here. Now, if you draw a tangent at any point, it will show the direction of velocity at that point. See, the direction is continuously changing. The vector along this direction is called tangential vector, whose magnitude is unit. As you know, the magnitude of any unit vector is unit. So it only shows the direction of velocity of this moving particle, which is moving along the curve path. Now here at the point P, at the same time two similar unit vectors are shown. What does it mean? At that point the velocity of the particle must be zero. Why? Because with respect to the q, if you measure the velocity, the direction will be along this et, because this is the tangential to the p when we consider the curve pq. And if you consider the curve bp, then the tangential direction is this. So a particle cannot have two similar direction at same moment, so the velocity must be zero. Another way we can say that at that point the particle is changing its direction of motion. So if earlier it was moving along this direction, after this point it has changed its direction towards this, so it must pass through the point zero so that it can change the direction. So here the velocity of the particle is zero. This is called a tangential vector or tangential unit vector. Now by using that we can easily write a velocity vector this way. V is equal to V tangential unit vector. From our earlier calculation, we know the velocity of a particle can be written as the time derivative of the position vector, where r is the position vector. Now we will try to relate the r with the et. See, it is a Cartesian coordinate system. In a Cartesian coordinate system, we have shown initial position of the particle here by denoting the r vector, and after delta time, the particle has arrived at that position following this curve path. As you can see, this curve path. Now the new position can be defined by using this vector r plus del r, means the position vector r has changed little bit, that is del r, in a time interval delta. See, this r plus del r does not depend on the tangential unit vector, because we can take the origin anywhere else. If we take the position of origin anywhere else, then the direction position vector will change. So it has no relation with the et. It does not depend on it. But the del r, it will not change. It remains fixed. Del r is what? Del r is the minimum distance in between these two points, which is called displacement. The distance covered by the particle during delta time is not same as del r, but it is the arc length of this arc, which is represented as del s, and del r is the displacement, means the minimum distance. See, wherever you take the origin, this del r does not change, so the del r has a direct relation with the tangential vector et. Now see, if we consider a very small time interval delta, then what will happen? This point will be gradually shifting along this curve, means if I gradually decrease the time interval, means del r also will decrease, because with respect to time the position has changed. So if we take very small time interval, then the next position will be very closer to the earlier position, so del s will become approximately same as the del r. Try to understand it. If I take the point somewhere here, then what will happen? This much will be del s, and this point will come here, and del r will have the approximate same length as del s. and ET, Dillard and the earlier ET, all will be acting along the same line, isn't it? So this way we can write the time derivative of Dillard means dr means change in position with respect to time can be written as this way, Dillard del t, where del t tends to 0. Now Dillard can be replaced by the del s, because when del t tends to 0, the length of Dillard and the length of del s are same, and the direction of Dillard is same as the et. As we have just discussed, if we take very small time interval, this point will come closer to the earlier point somewhere here, means this E vector will be continuously rotating this way, and finally del r et will be along the same line, means the direction will become same, and the magnitude of del r will be same as the del s, means if I take the point here, then del s will be this much, del r will also be this much. So we can write the del r as the del s et, where et shows the direction which is along del r, and del s shows the magnitude. Now we finally get, after differentiation, that dr dt is equal to ds dt et, where ds dt can be represented as time derivative means s dot. So v can be written this way. So by using this tangential unit vector, we can write the velocity of a particle which is moving along a curve path. Now suppose I want to get the acceleration of that particle, so I have to again differentiate this v with respect to time. So by differentiating this v with respect to time, what will you get? Differentiation of s dot, we have to follow the u product v rule. First we have to keep et constant, and we have to differentiate the s dot. By differentiating that, we get s double dot s double dot et, plus second time we have to keep the s dot constant, and we have to differentiate the et. After differentiation of et, it will become det dt. Okay, so finally the acceleration of the particle which is moving along a curve path can be written as two part. One is s double dot et. S double dot is what? It is the time derivative of the linear displacement, and s double dot is the twice time derivative of the linear displacement, and s dot is the one time derivative of the linear displacement. To know the result of the derivative of et with respect to time means to know det dt, we can see this analysis. See, suppose at a time the position of the particle was at A and the tangential unit vector was et A, and suppose initially the position was at B and the tangential unit vector was ETB. After del t time, the particle has covered del theta angular displacement, and it has come to a new position A, where the tangential unit vector is ETA. Though these two vectors seems same, but it are very different, because it shows the tangential unit vector for different positions, not for the same position. Now see, if I connect one more vector in between the endpoint of these two vector, I will get the change in tangential unit vector with respect to time, means with respect to del theta. Now if I take very small del theta, then this change in tangential unit vector will become perpendicular, isn't it? If I take very small del theta, then it will become perpendicular, and the length of these two vector will become same. Suppose the length of these two vector are simply capital R. Now we can find the change in unit vector with change in tangential unit vector with respect to time this way, by putting limit tends del t tends to 0. What does it mean? Limit del theta also tends to 0. Then we can write del et del t is equal to del theta del t en. What is en? When del theta becomes very small, this del et becomes perpendicular, so it shows a new direction. That direction is considered as en cap. Okay, so this del et vector, this vector can be written as del theta en. How? Here these two vectors are what? We have considered the magnitude as r, but it should be 1, because these are unit vector, and the magnitude of the unit vectors always be 1. So this length of this line will be r del theta, where r is equal to 1. So finally the length is del theta and the direction is perpendicular to it. That perpendicular direction is called En cap, perpendicular to the tangential vector, which is called normal vector. So after differentiating the tangential unit vector, we will finally get del theta del t, that can be written as theta dot time derivative of theta En, means along the normal direction. So the total acceleration of a particle which is following a curve path is can be written as s double dot et plus s dot theta dot en. See the first relation again, it was det dt, which is been replaced by theta dot en. Okay, now what is the magnitude of theta dot? That can be found this way by following this relationship. See, here the two position of the particle is considered along a curve path. So the initially the particle was here and finally it has come here. Now if I consider very small time interval, then the del theta also tends to be 0, then the particle B, the position B will be very closer to the position A. Okay, then we can write in place of, we can follow the relation s equal to r theta when del theta tends to 0. So we can write del s is equal to r del theta. If the position of B is closer to A, then RA and RB will be equal to A, say it is R. So we can write del S equal to R del theta. So we can write del theta equal to del S by R. So in place of del theta, we can write del S by R. So as R is a constant, so after differentiation, del S can be written as S dot and R as it is. So theta dot can be replaced by S dot by R. So here, if you replace the theta dot by s dot by r, then s dot finally it will be s dot square. And s dot means we know the velocity of the particle, linear velocity, so which can be represented by v. So it finally becomes v square by r, and the direction is normal, means perpendicular to the tangent, means towards the center of radius of curve, center of curvature. Okay, so this is the brief introduction about curvilinear motion. Now we'll go for a special kind of curvilinear motion, which is called known as projectile motion. Whenever a body is thrown at an angle with the ground, means not perpendicular, at any angle you can throw it, it should not be only perpendicular, then the particle or body follow a curve path. That path is called projectile. Okay, see, if I throw it at 90 degree to the vertical direction, vertically upward direction, then it will follow a straight path. It will attain some height, again it will come back to the ground following the same path. But when we will throw it at an angle, then it will follow a curve path. That curve path always be a projectile path, and it will be a parabolic path. After deriving the relationship, we can get that. And before that, we can say one thing. When a particle is moving in air, then the only force acting on it is due to the gravity, if we neglect the air drag and other kind of resistances. So here the acceleration is constant. No one is applying any extra force on it. So one thing we can write, double derivative of displacement with respect to time is equal to constant. If you integrate this equation, finally you will get a parabolic relationship. So we can say one thing, that whenever the acceleration of the moving body is constant, the displacement graph will be a parabolic path. See, here a particle has been thrown from the point O with a velocity u at an angle theta with the ground. So initially at that point, if we split the velocity, we will get two components, one along the vertical, that is u sin theta, and one along the horizontal, that is u cos theta. So the particle will be gradually moving in the upward direction, and there will be a specific point when it will attain the maximum height. After that, it will again start to return back following a curve path like this. Okay. Now see, at that point, means at the topmost point, what will be the vertical velocity? It should be 0. Why? Because if it not 0, then it should not change its direction in vertical direction. It should be moving in the upward direction. So it must be 0 because it is changing its direction of motion here. But the horizontal component should not be changing because in the horizontal direction, it is not changing its direction. It is moving in the same direction. And one more thing, as there is no resistances along the horizontal, so the velocity should not be 0. It should not be changing because if velocity changes, that means what? Acceleration or retardation is there. And only a force can cause acceleration or retardation. As there is no force along the horizontal direction, so there is no acceleration, so there should not be any change in velocity. But as there is acceleration along the vertical direction, that means there is a continuous force which is acting, which is pushing the body to which pushes the body to stop. Okay. Now see, by using this velocity component, we can find the required parameters. What are the required parameters for the projectile motion? The first thing is range. Range means the horizontal distance covered by the particle. Then the maximum height, this one. And the last one is time of travel. How long the body floats in the air. That is called time of flight or time of travel. By using these three general equations, we can easily find these three parameters. So first we will calculate the time of flight. See, if I see half of this motion and if I consider the vertical motion only, then by following this relation v equal to u minus ft or u plus ft, we can get the time of flight, where v is the initial vertical velocity u sin theta, final velocity is 0 at that point, and g is the acceleration which is acting downward, so should be negative. So by putting this all, we can get t is equal to what? So here in place of u, you need to write u sin theta because initial velocity is u sin theta, final velocity is 0. So u sin theta is equal to gt. So t is equal to u sin theta by g. We have considered half of the path. So for the whole path, it will be 2 times u sin theta by g. Now to get the horizontal range, we can follow this relationship. And we have to follow the horizontal motion. In horizontal motion, the initial velocity is u cos theta, though the final velocity will be also u cos theta, and acceleration is 0. So we know the time taken by the particle to reach this position, which is time of flight. It will be same for the horizontal also. So by putting this time of flight here and in place of u, by writing u cos theta, we will get u cos theta multiplied 2u sin theta by g. 2u sin theta by g is the time. So finally, in the numerator, we will get 2u sin theta cos theta, and denominator g. 2u sin theta cos theta has a trigonometric, can be replaced by a trigonometric formula, that is 2 sin 2 theta. So it is u square sin 2 theta by g. Now to get the maximum height, we again can follow the vertical motion. So by following this relationship, v square equal to u square minus 2gs, we can get the s, means the height. Here v is 0, u is u sin theta initial velocity, and g is g. So it will be u square by 2g. So u square sin square theta by 2g. Okay. Now the trajectory. Trajectory means the path followed by the particle. The equation of that path is called trajectory. So equation of trajectory can be found this way. See, if you take any point on this path, suppose I am considering this point. Now find out the coordinate of this point. What will be the coordinate? Along the x, the distance is u cos theta, and along the y, it is along the x, this much distance is, if the time taken to reach this point is t, so the x coordinate will be t into the velocity along x, that is t u cos theta. Okay, for that it is written t u cos theta. And to reach vertically the point at t time, what will be the distance? Again, by following this relationship, in place of u, we will write u sin theta, and in place of t, as it is t, and in place of g, as it is g, because g is the acceleration in the vertical direction. So y can be written as this: u sin theta t minus half g t square. Okay, so u sin theta t minus, it will be half g t square. Okay, it's not correctly written, it will be half g t square. Now from the first equation we can get the value of t as x by u cos theta, and from the second equation we can get the value of the t also. Then we can compare those values to get the equation. Or one thing also we can do that will be much easier: from the first equation we can take the value of t, then we can replace the t in the second equation. So it will be x by u cos theta, that we can put it back in the second equation. We will get the trajectory of the projectile motion.